So we believe autonomy is coming and we believe the value this could bring to our industry. So when we think about the impact autonomous vehicles can have to our business, it's something that we figuratively want to be both in the passenger and the driver's seat as the models for autonomy and the capabilities are being developed. And we really wanted to get an academic approach to really understanding the capability of autonomy and how it's going to work within our network.
So in alignment with those goals, plus the alignment of our charitable foundation, which also supports those goals of really furthering our communities and our involvement in our communities, we found great synergy when we found Georgia Tech. Part of the reason Georgia Tech was a natural fit for us is because they're a leader in industrial and systems engineering. And they're helping us get a better answer on how we're really going to approach autonomous vehicles as they come at us in the next 10 years.
ISW is the number one school of its kind and has been ranked that highly for many years, both at the undergraduate and the graduate level. And what that means is that we have really the world-class faculty in our field, and we also are able to recruit, educate, and work with the very best students. Collaborations are key to successful research. Pascal is a world-renowned researcher in fields such as transportation, mobility, and energy. So some of Pascal's latest work focuses on issues surrounding autonomous trucking, and the technology that enables this has the potential to revolutionize and to transform the transportation and the freight industry in particular.
When Ryder came to us, we're saying, hey, look at these problems that we have. We were very interested to see if the techniques that we were using for people mobility could actually apply more generally to freight. And that's how it started, you know, discussion with Ryder on what their needs were. Can we apply some of the techniques that we had seen before? And then it emerged, you know, this nice piece of research emerged from that.
So working with Pascal and his team at Georgia Tech was fantastic. They came from a different area of mobility and brought that outside-of-the-box thinking into commercial transportation. So it was important for us to provide real-world data to the Georgia Tech team so we know that this wasn't a hypothetical solution.
We were very fortunate to work with a team of experts. So you work with people who know the business, they know what the problems in the fields really are. So the problem is that Ryder has a dedicated fleet of trucks, and they do that because the truck has to be there, has to be ready for the customers at the right time. But when you do that, sometimes the trucks are traveling a lot of miles completely empty. So what is the model that we are envisioning? We are looking at autonomy, but in a very limited context. We are going to design a network, which is the autonomous network. And this is essentially autonomous connection between hubs.
So when we think about long-haul drivers today, one of the most inconsistent part of his journey is when he's in that first and final mile in the city. That's when we're getting traffic, we're getting pedestrians, left-hand turns.
And we want to keep essentially human drivers there. And then we'll have an autonomous part which move from a hub in a highway. And then when you move to a highway, you can have a dedicated lane, for instance, for the autonomous trucks.
When it gets off the highway, it can pull into a hub and that load can be moved to a truck with a driver who can make that final delivery. So we're still getting the benefits of autonomy over 70, 80, 90% of the journey, and we're leaving the really hard stuff for drivers to make that first and final mile delivery.
So I worked a lot on different transportation problems in the past. And you know, if you have 1% improvement, that's like magic, right? And here we are talking about, you know, improvement that goes from 29 to 40%, depending upon, you know, the savings that you're gonna get. And so it's massive. It's really massive. So I think if we have the will to actually move to a system like that, we can do it in this decade. I mean, you don't have to solve the complete autonomous vehicle problem here. You are talking about infrastructure. I think what we did is answering the business question and the operational questions. So if there is the will to build that infrastructure, I think we can move very fast with a system like this.
So when we think about the pandemic and the disruption that happened to our supply chain, we really want to make sure we're investing in technology that helps us prepare for that in the future, really expose some gaps in our supply chains. And so when we think about autonomous vehicles, the ability for that to solve issues when drivers aren't available or able to get quicker turns on trucks and really increase where these trucks are go and how long they can stay on the road, it really should help us kind of keep the supply chain moving in the case of future pandemics.